To report that Crossref is doing very well. So, thanks very much. I'm going to be doing some fuller stats and a full update during the main part of the meeting. This year we've sort of had the corporate meeting first, and then at 10 a.m. we're going to have the more public meeting where we'll have a wider group of attendees. So I will get into some of the statistics, and we'll be hearing shortly from our treasurer, Linda Beebe, about the current state of Crossref. So this morning I wanted to talk a little bit about the July strategic board meeting. The board of directors meets quarterly. Three meetings during the year are one-day meetings, but every July there's a meeting that goes over 2 days, and it gives the board a chance to have some more in-depth strategic discussions. And the board wanted me to provide a report back from that meeting, because there were some, we took a little different approach this year. And we brought in a facilitator, Jonathan Clark, for the first time. It's the first time we've ever done anything like that. And we brought him in to help organize our strategic discussions. So he did this by having us do a number of what are called innovation games. So the board broke up into smaller groups. We'd done a survey of the board beforehand to raise any important topics, and that helped guide what happened over the next few days. So it was a very hands-on meeting in Edinburgh in July. And the first session that we did involved breaking into groups and discussing the future of the publishing industry. So this is one of the groups hard at work, and it was called 2020 Hindsight. So everybody had to imagine it was 2020, and we were looking back on what happened in the publishing industry over the previous decade, and put in milestones for important developments, and that would help provide a big picture framework for the discussions we were having over the next few days. This is the results. Quite a complicated timeline, but this was sort of distilled down into key events that would happen in each year, and things to do with you know, open access and mandates and various other industry issues. And that was very useful. The next stage was to actually think about Crossref's mission itself. So from a survey done before the board meeting, there was a series of statements and phrases that were put on index cards, and the board again split into groups, and they had to come up with a series of statements that captured Crossref's mission. We took this and put it into a Wordle. This is a mashup where all the terms are in proportion to the size of how much they were used, and this seemed to capture very well a lot of the themes that came up in the board discussions. So obviously, scholarly communications, broad community, infrastructure, trusted, collaborative. These are all things that are continuing themes for Crossref as an organization. So this was useful to show that, by and large, you know, there were some differences, but by and large, the board was aligned on what Crossref's mission should be. And then after the meeting, one of the statements was chosen by the executive committee as very succinct summation of Crossref's mission. And this is what the statement was: Crossref is a collaborative, trusted organization that is integral to the evolution of scholarly communication. So you'll note that it's a very, very broad statement. It doesn't mention DOIs or reference linking. But I think it's important because, of course, while we need to continue to invest in the current system and in the current services, this shows that Crossref actually has a very broad remit to serve the industry and to develop new services and new projects going forward. Diving down then to a more detailed level, the final stage of the exercises was called pruning the tree. And so again, we had a lot of, done with surveys done before the meeting, we had a lot of the key projects and topics for Crossref that were put on index cards again, and then the different groups had to place the projects on the tree, the roots, the trunk, the branches, obviously with things going up into the branches being less important, and it really forced people to prioritize all the projects
that Crossref has going on, all the possible things we could do. That's always an issue for Crossref. It's a good problem to have. That in lots of areas, people say, "Oh, Crossref could do something there," but it's very important to be able to focus and have a clearer strategic direction for the organization. And I'll go through what the board what the result of this was, and this was then subsequently used by staff for developing the 2011 budget for next year. So the first set of high priority projects were Books, Crossmark, and ORCID. Those are all on the agenda for later today. So those are obviously important strategic projects for Crossref. The next level is interesting because it actually touches more on existing services. Metadata quality, of course, is always a priority for Crossref. There was some detailed talk about that yesterday at the workshop, some of the things that we're working on in terms of metadata quality audits for members. DOI pub plugins, this is a broader area where we're trying to develop tools to make it as easy as possible for researchers to use Crossref DOIs. We have a blog plugin so that people that Crossref Labs developed, and so that we want to continue with that work, and also generally more feedback to publishers, again about metadata quality, about broken links. Those types of issues are very important, and we'll hear a little bit about the new Crossref deposit system later this morning that will help us give that better feedback to publishers. The next level down, Crossref metadata search. In the past, we had a project of Crossref search, which was full text search across publishers' full text. That project ran as a pilot for a while. It was ended finally earlier this year. But Crossref metadata search is actually searching across the Crossref metadata database, and again on Crossref Labs, there's a beta service that allows people to actually do quick searches across the metadata. That's something that could be further developed. The board has also been engaged in discussions about displaying Crossref DOIs as URLs. Right now, it's DOI colon, and then the DOI is the recommended format. We're considering shifting to the recommended display as always having HTTP :// for starting it, so that it's more easily embedded into workflows. It's more easily identified as an actionable link online. And we're also considering ways that we can highlight it more as a Crossref DOI. GOI is soon to be approved as an ISO standard. There are other registration agencies who will be applying to DOIs to other types of content. They may have different ideas of persistence, different services than Crossref offers. For example, Movie Labs is creating a registry for the movie industry using DOI. So it's a fantastic development, but it also highlights that in future, different DOIs will have different services. So we want to highlight that Crossref DOIs have are kept persistent by Crossref, and we have a set of rules around Crossref itself and DOIs. Getting farther down, a little farther out, we have cross-check duplicate submission, which will come up a little bit later today. And then also, Crossref should be capable of accepting components, tables, figures from articles. And we do have quite a few components that are being registered, but that's seen as an important area going forward. Now, it's also true that some things got pruned off the tree, but there's also a key area of what's the next stage, what should we be investigating and looking at for 2011. Linking to data sets is a key strategic area, and we are planning to work with DataCite. DataCite is a new DOI registration agency. It was founded by the British Library, the TIB, the Technical Library in Germany, and about 15 organizations, and it's going to try to do for data sets what Crossref has done for DOIs, but actually more for journal articles and other scholarly content. But it's more of a community focus. Crossref is serving the publishing community, and DataCite is going to be serving the sort of national data center, national library world, so that publishers who are Crossref members who have data sets would still register them with Crossref. Other types of organizations will work with DataCite, but we're planning on working very closely with DataCite so that the journals and books and conference proceedings can link to these large national databases. Patents is identified as a key area. We can see in Crossref statistics that we can see that people are searching references, they're looking for patents. So we want to look at both linking from the current Crossref content out to patents and then from patents back to journals. That's already happening to some extent, but we are talking to a group in Australia called Cambia, a non-governmental organization that has developed a service called Patent Lens and doing a lot of work in patents. So we're looking to see how we can work with them a little bit more closely on developing the patent area. A couple other things are supporting scholarly metrics. Crossref has a lot of metadata that may be useful, something just to investigate, something to research. PIRIS, we're involved in, it's the institutional repository, publisher and institutional repository usage factor. So this is connected to the journal usage factor project that UKSG is leading, that Richard Getty is leading, and that's due to report, finish up at the end of the year and report early next year. It involves DOI, so we're engaging with that. And then a little farther down the list, improving access in the developing world. Crossref already works with a group called INASP, which is based in Oxford, and they have a journal online program, which is getting journals from the developing world online, and so we're working very closely with them that we waive deposit fees for journals that come from countries in the low-income countries as defined by the World Bank, and that's actually been coming along fairly well. We might look at other ways we can try to expand that. And again, there's some interest in looking at how we can facilitate research uses of the Crossref metadata. In the past, we've done this on a case-by-case basis, and I think that's the plan going forward. In terms of pruning the tree, some things that kind of fell off the actual list of things that we would be actively engaged in, not that we wouldn't do, but that are farther away from sort of active engagement, things like text mining, established linking services to other types of scholarly content, blogs and wikis, metadata management for other organizations, and gateway links to other types of content, say newspapers or trade books, things like that. So this was a very, very important exercise, and really this the last two slides I showed you are informing what Crossref is doing. It's informed the 2011 budget as well. The board didn't work all the time. They had a very good dinner in the evening in a restaurant in Edinburgh, and you can see, though, they still had their sleeves rolled up, working hard there. But I think this is important to show, too, because, of course, Crossref is only successful because of its board, its staff, and all of you, its members, and all the partners that we work with as well. And so I think the human aspect of what Crossref does and why we're successful is very important. And so I would encourage everyone on the day when we're electing the board. One way to get involved in Crossref is on various committees. Of course, we have board committees and audit committee and things like that. These are some of the committees where we have general members are able to participate and join. We have the membership and fees committee, which of course talks about fees for new services, but also membership policies. The technical working group is being reformed into a more focused group called the Technical Operations Committee to help provide advice on technical matters. And of course, when we start up new projects like CrossCheck and CrossMark, we start with working groups, and then when the products services go live, we move them into more formal committees. And then a little later on today, we're going to be hearing about what's happening in the books area. So I would encourage you to talk to a board member, talk to a staff member, if you're interested in getting involved in any of these committees.
So I think that's all for my review at the moment. So we'll be hearing a little bit more detail at 10 o'clock about various